Perfect, do it again.
Stand by two. Take two.
Good afternoon. I'm very glad to see all of you here for our panel.
Stand by one.
I will not welcome you as a task that the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences has undertaken. But I do, before we begin, want to thank a number of people and institutions who have helped make this effort possible. First of all, we're all very grateful to C-SPAN supporting this event, in addition to Center for the Humanities in an Urban Environment. So if you miss it on C-SPAN in April, you can always come to our website and see it as well. The Center for the Humanities in an Urban Environment and the Cuban Research Institute are very proud to be able to sponsor this event and to thank a number of other groups, including the College of Arts and Sciences, the FIU Library, the Exile Studies Program, the English Department, the Latin American and Caribbean Center, the panelists, and I'm particularly grateful to my program assistants, Aramis Martinez, who is the person who suggested this event and initiated the process. So thank you all for coming. Let me ask Dean Michael Heidhaus of the College of Arts and Sciences to come to the podium to welcome you.
That works. Good afternoon, and thank you all for being here. Welcome to FIU. I am really excited to have this panel here and to be able to have this discussion. As one of the largest Hispanic-serving institutions in the country and the public research university for our culturally diverse city, we really take seriously having these kinds of conversations and engaging with the public for issues that affect our students, our faculty, our families, and our community, both here locally and around the country. You know, if you really think about it, Miami itself is largely a city of exiles, not just from Cuba, but from all over the world. So we're following these issues at a national level very, very closely on immigration and immigration reform because of its effect on us. And I'm really excited to hear the opinions we have of our distinguished panel and to hear the questions that come and the discussion that comes from the audience. I will keep it brief because nobody wants to hear the guy with the tie. So it is my honor to present Dr. Jorge Duany, Director of FIU's Cuban Research Institute.
Michael Vespi for inviting us to participate in this event as co-sponsors of panel today. I'm pleased to introduce our four guest speakers. We have three right now, but we'll hopefully have the fourth one in a few minutes. And then after their interventions, I will moderate the answer period. So I think we're going to change the order of the presentation according to Dr. Vespi, who's with us here. So let me first introduce our first speaker, Helen Aguirre Ferrer. Aguirre Ferrer is an award-winning bilingual journalist who hosts a political talk show, Zona Política, and moderates a weekly public affairs series issues on WP72. I could say a lot more, but I'll be very brief and then move on to the next speaker. Secondly, we'll have Father Thomas Weinstein, who has been, since 2010, fourth Archbishop of Miami, and he previously served as Bishop of Orlando, and has a very long record with various immigrant groups, Cuban and Haitian. Our third speaker will be Dahlia Walker Hutchinson, who is an attorney and the principal of the law offices of Dahlia Walker, PA from Hollywood, Florida, and counsel to Hamilton Miller and Berthisel in Miami. She practices the area of immigration, family, and criminal law and is a native of Jamaica. Our fourth speaker, who will hopefully be actually just here, so welcome, will be Jepsy Metellus, who is a co-founder and executive director of SANGOM, the Haitian Neighborhood Center of Miami, a strong advocate of the Haitian community in South Florida, especially women and residents. So without further ado,
thank you so much, and I'd like to thank everybody for being here. I'd like to thank FIU for hosting this conversation, and I like it that it's framed as a conversation because I think we have too few conversations in our country in general. We shall not come to that really deserves meaningful conversation. I love it that this conversation is also occurring the day after St. Patrick's Day, where we celebrate something that is so fascinating, which is the Irish tradition, which seems so foreign to us here in South Florida, and yet it's such a central core. There were many Hispanics and African-American and Blacks who were sporting green yesterday in recognition of St. Patrick's Day. And it's interesting because obviously that is part of the immigrant phenomena, which is so much a part of the fiber of our country. We've always had a struggle with immigration, and anyone who is Irish or a few generations back can tell you that being Irish was not always an easy experience. Hispanics today will tell you, well, perhaps then we are the ones who have replaced the Irish, and we are the ones who are experiencing, and of course the Haitian American community could also speak to that, but I will be back for Justine as well as others to address that issue. It seems odd to me that we are even talking about immigration in the form of the Clinton term, a country that is, we consider the number one leader in the world, a country that is the largest, not the largest, but one of the greatest democracies in the world, world leader on so many fronts, can't get this issue right. It's one of those things that just keeps us stalled in policy debates as if this was, pardon the pun, a foreign conversation, when it's not. It's something that's so basic and elemental and part of the fiber of our country. And yet we see that it's stalled regardless of who's in power and where the majority lies in Washington. When the Democrats were in absolute power in 2008 and 2010, one would have thought that they would have taken the happy opportunity to pass immigration reform at that point in time. And they chose not to. They passed other legislation, including health care reform, and the one promise that was made to the Hispanic community was squandered. Something that has been reminded of the Democratic community and President Obama in particular, time and time again. The Republicans complain about illegal immigration and do the same. Nothing. They stop all discussion and all conversation as if doing nothing is an answer or a solution to the problem. Border security is an important part of the conversation, and Republicans will tell you that it's the first thing that needs to be addressed. Many would agree, but go ahead and address it. And yet, they don't. And when you do have border legislation, it's scuttled because there's this desire to have a majority Republican voice in this thought or in approving this piece of legislation, when it really isn't. And one would wish that leadership on both sides of the aisle would reach out to each other and say, what can we do to make this happen, to bring the country together? And who would disagree that we do not need to bring the country together on this very important issue? What to do with the undocumented immigrants that are here? Well, here's a newsflash. The undocumented ultimately end up becoming citizens. Why? Because they have American-born children who, when they become of age, ultimately claim their parents. Not the case for all, as Dreamers will attest. But certainly, it is a reality for very many. In very short period of time, 40% of the workforce will be non-Hispanic age, non-Hispanic working age men and women. Their growth in the job market is going to be almost zero. Minority communities are having more children than white families. From an economic perspective, it makes all the sense in the world. From a religious perspective, and I'm going to leave that for man who saves souls to discuss, but out of humanity, out of history, out of a sense of community and an understanding of our history, immigration reform should be resolved. And in 2008, 2016, if this is not a resolved issue, it will further divide the country in ways that will be more.
I'm Archbishop Rinsky, and I worked many years in the Haitian community, 18 years, in the late 70s, all through the 80s, and into the 90s when I became an auxiliary bishop of Miami, and then bishop of Havana, now Archbishop of Miami. Immigration has been part of my life all those years. The last major immigration reform was accomplished in 1986 under President Reagan. And that included an amnesty that certainly benefited this community to the good in many, many ways. By the mid-90s, and towards the end of the 90s, we realized that that legislation did not address all the issues that needed to be addressed. And it was clear that we faced a broken immigration system. And so, since that time, we've been trying to advocate for a fix, a reform of our immigration system. The United States Capitol Bishops, in the year 2001, issued a pastoral letter that was also signed on to by the bishops of Mexico, entitled Strangers No Longer, in which we set out our priorities on immigration reform and what shape it should take. We were lucky in that both the staff of Senator Ted Kennedy and Senator McCain used that document to put forth an immigration reform proposal that was on the table in the early part of the 2000s. I remember I went up to Washington, D.C. in September 9th. 10th of 2001, I think on the 9th, President Sanford Fox addressed a joint session of Congress in which he also underlined the need for immigration reform. The next day, I and another bishop went to see the head of IMS at that time, a gentleman by the name of Ziegler, and he said, bishops, we're going to get it fixed. It's going to be fixed pretty soon. Got on my plane, flew back to Miami, went to bed. I got up the next morning and I was going to work on the radio. 9/11 basically changed the equation. America went into a bad mood. And we have yet to emerge from that bad mood. That bad mood has been stymieing our efforts to initiate the reform. So we have the Senator McCain bill, which was basically should be the gold standard, the Kennedy McCain bill that came out this year. It was going to provide a very good, very reasonable, very humane and just immigration reform. It didn't make it, partly because of the bad mood resulting from the 9/11 attacks. Later on, Senator Mel Martinez from Florida attempted another iteration of an immigration reform bill that was found in 2006. He and Senator Hagel. It wasn't as good as the Kennedy McCain bill, at least in my eyes, but it was acceptable. And that wasn't able to get through, partly because by that time, President Bush had lost his political capital. And he supported both the Kennedy McCain bill supported the Martinez table bill, but he lost political capital to twist elbows and twist arms at unnecessary votes in the House and the Senate. At the same time, it was interesting to note that Democrats, who generally have been usually, at least publicly, in favor of immigration reform, decided to let President Bush out alone on this issue. In fact, Ron Emanuel, now the mayor of Chicago, was a big influential guy in the House at the time, congressman. He went around the Democrats in the House and said, don't you dare vote for immigration reform. party would not give you any money. Why did he do that? Basically because they wanted to make sure that immigration reform would not pass while there was a Republican in the White House. So they were going to wait, Democratic White House, so they would do immigration reform, and also, you know, use that to their political advantage. And as you already heard, Democrats had both the White House and a majority in both the Senate and the House, they didn't act upon it. We still are struggling, we still are advocating for immigration reform. We were happy for DACA, which was, they believe, one of the dreamers. We were happy for it because it wasn't what we wanted. We wanted the Dream Act. We couldn't get it, so we applauded administrative resolution. Not a solution, but a band-aid that provided relief for thousands of, hundreds of thousands of young people. We supported DAPA, which is the latest administrative action of President Obama to provide relief to parents of U.S. who have children that are U.S. citizens or U.S. residents. That was going to perhaps help out maybe 5 million of the 11 or so million undocumented in our country today. The president announced it. In doing so, he angered Republicans. And of course, they initiated some action in the House to defund it, to derail it one way or the other. Before they had a chance to do that, some judge in Texas ruled it unconstitutional, and it's on hold until it's appealed to a higher court, and hopefully that will be overturned. Unfortunately, even if it's overturned, it's only a temporary fix, because it doesn't provide legalization, it doesn't provide a path to citizenship. It just says that for X amount of months, you can get a work permit, you can get a driver's license, and you can be in the country without legal status. That's not a solution, it's not a permanent solution, but we support it. We think that the president did have the authority to do it, and we think it's a good temporary stop. But what we do need, and we can't do it without Congress, we do need a fix to a broken immigration system. And the Captain Bishops have been saying for the past 10 plus years that immigration reform should have three legs. Three legs to it. One leg is a path to citizenship for the 11 million or so. These people are already part of our American society, even though they're not, they don't enjoy legal status. They have American children, American citizens who are children. They might have spouses that are American citizens, their neighbors. They're already integrated into the fabric of our society. And even Republicans admit that we're not going to be able to deport 11 million people. So if we're not going to deport them, then we should give them a path to legalization. And that path to legalization really is not only in their interest, it's in our own self-interest as an American society. Because by leaving 11 million people outside the legal status, we're basically creating a nation, a new sanction underclass that's exploitable because they don't have legal protection. The last time we did this as a nation, we called it Jim Crow. And we haven't been able to overcome the effects of Jim Crow even to date. So why would we want to do it again for another million people? So that's the first leg. Given the 11 million in this country, a path to the other leg would be family reunification. One of the reasons why we have this trouble at the border of people being smuggled in, people, like children that came in or still coming in over Texas border, is many of these people are looking for reunification with their families who are already here. When in the 1990s, our government started to increase security on the border, militarized the border, a lot of people that used to go back and forth to Mexico and go work in Apple's in the Seattle area, well, they found it was harder to get back and forth, so they stayed in the United States. And they didn't have a vocation to celibacy, so they wanted to have their wives with them and their children with them. And that created a whole new business of coyote smuggling women and children across the border. And we have more than one case of women and children dying in the back of trucks, suffocated because they're being brought across the border. And it's a desperate attempt to reunite with family members. Right now, if you're a Mexican and you are a legal U.S. resident or citizen, and you have a wife or a child in Mexico, you have to wait 10 years before that person can get a visa to come to this country. The same is true if you're in the Philippines and many other countries. So, people say, well, they stay in line. Well, in many cases, there is no line, but a line has no end. So family unification visas have to be rationalized and the backlogs eliminated so that there isn't an incentive for illegal migration for people that are just wanting to unite their families and their best families. So that's the second leg. The third leg is a worker program. We have to assure our American businesses a supply of legal workforce. I think most people working in service industry, working in the agricultural industry, would prefer to have a legal workforce. And right now, if you have agribusiness, they're very nervous. They tend to vote Republicans, but they are in favor of immigration reform because they have a very narrow profit margin, and their ability to harvest crops and to get chickens to market and all that can be blown out of the water by some crazy enforcement measures taken by immigration authorities, et cetera. So they want immigration reform, and right now we have a system in which if you survive a dangerous gauntlet, you'll find a job someplace. And the immigrants have gone into every one of the 50 states. They've done it without any federal program directing them, but they go to where their jobs. If you look around our communities, not in the United States, the immigrants are not sleeping under bridges. They're not the ones that are sleeping under bridges. They go to where the jobs are and they find jobs. And so you find Central Americans and Mexicans working in onions in New York State, helping cows in New Hampshire, working in Alaska, everywhere. So why don't we rationalize this and allow these people to work legally? And that's immigration reform. Those three legs. Take care of the illegals that are here, the undocumented that are here, by providing them with a path to citizenship. Work out the kinks and the family unification program, and assure a legal workforce for industries that require workers, especially those on the low end of the economic scale. Now, back to 1986 when we did immigration reform. It was a tough lift back then, too. Reagan got it done. And it was interesting because, what we're seeing today in the United States, all this anti-immigrant feeling expressed in different areas. We lived it here in South Florida in the early 1980s. was mostly focused on Asians. That, indefinite detention policy for Asians, now detention policy for everybody. And I gotta shut up soon. Let me just say this, is that, what was a local problem here, has now become pretty much a national issue. However, let's look at South Florida. We survived it. Our experience of immigration in the 70s and 80s have shown us that we have nothing really to fear from immigration. Immigrants, are not problems, they're opportunities. But they bring gifts that, they bring, possibilities and dreams and determination, et cetera, et cetera. So, we can see how, we should be able to say that our South Florida, experience should show to the country that there's no greater immigration, that it is a positive for American society. And let me just end with a, Cuban adjustment. But a few weeks ago, I saw that our Cuban American Congress were advocating that now is the time to do it. And I thought that was a foolish thing, for that to say. Because that's what the Castro government has been saying for 20 years. So here we go. Politics makes strange bedfellows, doesn't it? And we have the hardline of Cuban Americans basically advocating for a position that the Cuban government has been advocating for 2 decades, do away with the Cuban Adjustment Act. I think the Cuban Adjustment Act it should be a template of how we should treat immigrants. Because Cubans have been the most successful immigrant group in American history. And one of the reasons for their success, sure they have their own talents and their own genius, et cetera, et cetera. But one of the reasons Cubans succeeded was because it was a Cuban Adjustment Act, which meant that 1 year after they were here, they had a green card, and 5 years later, 6 years later, they were U.S. citizens. So, I remember in the 80s, too, there was always a lot of comparisons made between the treatment that Cubans were getting and the treatment that Haitians were getting. Cubans were treated better than the Haitians. But the Haitians were not treated much worse than the Mexicans or the Hondurans or other people were treated. But the issue should be that we should treat Cubans as bad as we were treating everybody else. I think what we should argue for is that we should treat everybody else as good as we treat the Cubans, because that Cuban Adjustment Act works. And if it worked for Cubans, it would work for everybody else.
Thank you, Father. I'm a Cuban American, and I was asked to speak on about whether or not attorneys are more effective when they seek to shape immigration law or when they try to interpret the laws that exist. And the answer, my answer is that as attorneys, we have to do both. Lawyers are advocates. We represent our clients in the courtroom. We problem solve, we negotiate, and we also advocate. But most attorneys who practice immigration law in the United States are members of a national organization called the American Immigration Lawyers Association, or ALA. It's an advocacy group that has over 13,000 members. The mission of ALA, established in 1946, is to promote justice and to advocate for fair and reasonable immigration law and policy. Certainly, in the immigration law context, lawyers are the people with the most intimate knowledge of the laws themselves, the process, and we are the ones who see the day-to-day impact of immigration laws on individuals and families, both inside and outside of the United States. We see when parents are separated from sons and daughters for 7 to 10 years, and in the Mexican context, 21 years if you're filing for a son or a daughter who's over 21 years of age, and siblings who are separated for up to 13 years. ALA has a National Day of Advocacy. This year is in April 16th in Washington, where attorneys and representatives from all across the United States converge on DC to lobby Congress for for meaningful immigration laws, not just immigration reform. Because while we do know about the, and the numbers vary between 10 to 15 million people who are undocumented, there are also laws on the books that separate families. And I'll give you one example. If you are the parent of an American citizen and your son or daughter is over 21, you have remarried and you now have a new family. If you remarried after that son or daughter was 18, that stepchild cannot file for their step-parent. And also, if they file for their sibling, the sibling goes into a category that says they have to wait 13 years. So you have, once again, the separation of families. And as Helen said earlier, although America has a history of immigrants, we also have a bad history of limiting immigration. As each group assimilates, they turn, it seems, against the next wave of immigrants. The Irish, the German, the Polish, the Italians, the Eastern Europeans were not always welcome to America, but now they're established. And the newest immigrants, the Latinos, the Africans, and the Caribbean people are being resisted. And it's up to lawyers to partner with other groups, such as the churches and NGOs, to make and help to document the contribution that immigrants have made and continue to make to this great country. And while on that subject, it's not uncommon to hear people with the last names of Rubio and Cruz who are also anti-immigrants. As lawyers, we have to show the American people how they benefit from the reunification of families, which is supposed to be the hallmark of U.S. immigration. And in today's America, how America can benefit from keeping students who are educated in the United States in institutions such as FIU, but are forced to leave with their knowledge because they have no path, no clear path to residency or to entrepreneurship. The 12 to 15 million undocumented in this country definitely need a path to legislation, to legalization. And it should not take 13 years as was proposed in the Senate bill that passed in 2013. The people need to come out of the shadows. They need to obtain driver's license, make it safer for all of us on the street. They need to pay their back taxes, pass a criminal background check, and become permanent members of a society to which they contribute on a daily basis. Many are already paying their taxes, but even if they're not, they're part of the economy that contributes to the way in which we are able to live in this country, whether we want to believe it or not. Now, as lawyers, as an advocate for your client, we have a duty as lawyers to be knowledgeable of existing laws and to find ways to use the laws that exist to help our clients. Immigration law is complex. It's second in complexity only to the Internal Revenue Code. And it's not uncommon to have different applications of the law and to receive different answers from different USCIS agents. You call the 800 number today, you get one answer. You call tomorrow, you ask the same question, you get a different answer. And so the immigration lawyer has a responsibility to daily update themselves on what is happening in immigration law. In the criminal law context, defendants are entitled to counsel. And even deportation, which is the most severe of penalties, the separation of families, is not considered a criminal matter. It's considered civil proceeding. So there is no right to have counsel appointed to you in immigration law. You have the right to counsel only if you can afford it. And we saw last year with all of those children who were coming in, many of whom were 5, 6, 7 years old, who were sitting at tables such as these in front of immigration judges, not speaking the language and not having any representation. So NGOs and churches do try to provide free or reduced fee counsel, but the need outweighs the availability. And because of that, many immigrants, including adults, appear without counsel. As lawyers, we also have an ethical duty to take on cases that are within our competence. And knowing immigration law and giving the correct advice is a matter between remaining in the United States and being forever separated from your families. We have a responsibility to be at the forefront of advocacy, as far as I'm concerned, because of the knowledge that we possess, we're sometimes accused of not wanting non-lawyers to quote-unquote benefit from the business of immigration. And it's mind-boggling to me because even after practicing law for 17 years, my colleagues and I, we still call each other and bounce cases off each other because the whole study and maintaining of immigration law is so complex. And we're very overwhelmed in our heavily immigrant community in South Florida, which is so unique to have so many different countries represented here and some pockets of heavy different nations. We are overwhelmed with notarios and others who believe they know more about immigration law than practitioners who are submerging themselves in the practice every day. And so I do join with my two prior panelists in advocating that we need immigration reform in this United States. Not only did President Bush expend his political capital by not pushing, but President Obama also expended his political capital by not moving within the first 100 days as he promised to pass immigration law. And as a practitioner who is out there and also an advocate every day, I don't see it happening in the next 2 years within this Congress before the 2016 election. I hope to be proven wrong, but I don't see it happening. What has happened in Texas is that 26 states, including the state of Florida, joined a lawsuit to stop the president's executive action that he signed in November of last year. And it's interesting that the judge who issued the injunction against the enactment of the executive action didn't do it on the merits of the executive action, but chose to do so on procedure, saying that the president did not follow the procedure of putting it out there for a certain number of days, and it was a procedural or a technicality, as a non-lawyer would say, that has caused this executive action not to be implemented, which was going to have widespread results, not just the 5 million people who are expected to benefit from DACA, which is a deferred action for parents, but also the whole revamping of immigration, looking at it, and the president has as the executive of the country has the authority to decide how his agencies, in this case the Department of Homeland Security, how Homeland Security is going to implement the laws that are already on the books. And there is a law on the books right now. So technically, someone in Homeland Security, and this is done today, that a person comes up for deportation and that deportation is deferred and they're allowed to apply for a work permit. So what the president did in that regard was nothing that is not being done on a daily basis, but what he was saying is apply it across the board, invite people to come in and apply, come out of the shadows, get this monkey off your back, and continue to contribute to the United States. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's wonderful to actually benefit from all that you've heard from the previous speakers. So let me just add to remind us of what the imperative is for us in terms of seeking to achieve immigration reform. First and foremost, the heritage, the legacy, the values of our country clearly demonstrate that this is something, immigration is something we embrace in spite of the times where we've been not too welcoming to significant numbers of immigrants. But still, it remains in our national interest, it remains in our economic interest, it remains in our interest in terms of world prestige and moral authority that we live up to our values. I think no American disagrees with this, even those who appear to be today's anti-immigrant, anti-immigration reform voices, right? Second thing is that we all agree that immigration reform requires that we secure the border, requires that all of the people, 11 million plus people, for here in this country who seek to be legalized, who seek to have their status adjusted. Well, they must learn to speak English, and generally they do. They must pay their taxes, and they actively try to do this today, even through not a social security number, but through an IFN, right? They clearly want to be upstanding citizens of this country. They want to be participatory. They want to contribute to the growth of the economy. The children are in school and want to take every opportunity that this country offers, and everyone seeks to live the American dream, right? And so I don't think that in the immigration advocacy corner, no one, I don't think anyone disagrees with the several principles that I've just cited. Right? And so today, well, what's going on? You heard Archbishop reference the post 9/11 mood of this country, right? And I think there's some other elements too that explain the partisanship, the hyper-partisanship, the rancor, the nastiness, the gridlock, and all of the things that we know are dysfunctional about Congress today. And you know, I'm going to tell you the truth. I believe clearly, there's a black man in the White House. I think that's an element. I think that the anti-immigration forces and voices in this country have taken over and have drowned out the voices of the silent majority, which is many of us, right? Those of us who do nothing, say nothing, because we don't think that our voices matter. We don't think that we can, in fact, figure out ways to amplify those voices such that collectively we make an impact, right? And so when you've got this kind of mood, you're very minute. I won't even call them minute group of people who are holding the rest of us hostage, who are holding this process hostage, and of course are finding their voices through some elements that they elect to the Congress, who are then participating in this gridlock and resulting in us being the laughing stock of the world, you know? Where is our moral authority? Where is our authority to preach to others? Where is our authority to say to other countries, other peoples, and other areas of the world that they must do X, Y, and Z to either live up to their democratic values and ideals, to live up to human rights values and ideals, to live up to all of the standards that we are known to be identified with. And here we are trampling on those very same standards where I think large segments of our immigrants are concerned. You heard Archbishop mention the fact that Haitian immigrants in this country, this community in particular, were treated very, very badly. I think that there was probably some unwritten policy that suggested that Haitian immigrants were to be locked up. Haitian immigrants were to be detained indefinitely. Haitian immigrants were to be discouraged from coming into this country by any means necessary, whether that meant indefinite detention, whether that meant, look, you know, send them back. And even when morally, we could not withstand the public and the worldwide criticism. You know, I think we came up with, what was it, Wetford, Dryford? Some sort of policy to sort of attempt to say, well, yes, we understand that it doesn't look good that we would treat one group of immigrants in a certain way, which is in particular the Cubans, and yet treat Haitians who arrive here in this country under the same circumstances, and yet they're turned back. I'll tell you this story very quickly. A boat on high seas, Haitians on it, happened to meet a group of Cuban rafters whose, I don't know, transport mechanism was disintegrating. Picked them up, they all arrived here together. Guess what happens? Haitians are sent back, the Cubans are welcome. And so we saw and lived through a number of similar experiences. And so I leave it to you to make a final judgment. What I want to take this opportunity to remind you of, in spite of everything you heard, you know what we agree with. You know what every advocate, and you know whether or not we are Republican or Democrat, I think at the end of the day, we all want some of the same things that I mentioned. We need all of you to not grow the sector of bystanders who are the silent majority who say nothing when your voices are so powerful. We need you to urge your elected representatives to act on this. Yes, some of us think 2017 is possible. Some people say not, some people say yes, but still, we recognize though that our country, our economy cannot sustain this. We will not be able to deport all of these people. We know that business sectors and that are important to our economy need this labor force, need this workforce, and so they're on board. And so what is it that we're waiting for? Clearly, we recognize that there are some who favor providing visas to those individuals who are considered investors, who are going to invest in the economy, who are going to create jobs, who are going to help us in terms of our economic outlook. And I don't disagree with that totally, but I do also think that we need to make room for family reunification, as the Archbishop mentioned, because clearly all of the individuals who are already in this country, already doing the work that none of us would do today, right? The work that none of us would do today. These individuals are here doing this, striving to deserve a place, a spot in this great country, striving to live this American dream, and are having their dreams, their aspirations derailed by some individuals who seem to not understand what time it is, right? And so let me just close with reminding all of us, something I love to say, but I'm always so careful in the way I say it, because I don't want anyone to misquote me. I like to think that the American immigration system is probably the only Ponzi scheme that works, right? To the extent that, right, you come to this country as an immigrant, you apply for other relatives who come in, and they apply for successive numbers of relatives who come in, and all of us keep growing this economy, keep contributing, keep the country moving forward, provide our talents, and do all that we can to make this country what it is today. So is that not a scheme that works? Right? It's in our best interest to get it right, get it done, and it has to get done right. I'm going to stop right here for.
Thank you to all our guest speakers for a wonderful presentation and help me to recognize them.
Says that more immigration reform before 2017. That's strongly right, but I would hope that maybe some enlightenment might reach Congress, Republicans in Congress. And that would be one thing to think about it and see that it would be to their advantage, really, to get the immigration issue off the table before the primary season hits us after the summer. Because it certainly would help Jeb Bush if immigration wasn't going to be a hot button issue, if it was resolved by some immigration reform coming from Congress now rather than later. So, and of course, then you could also say on the other side, well, the Democrats, it might be to their advantage not to solve immigration now, because they would use it as a wedge issue in the next election. And so what we have to appeal to is both parties, better angels, and they don't look for the partisan advantage, but look for the common good. And the common good would be served by fixing this problem sooner than later, because the longer we wait to fix it, the longer we are seeing. I see it in parishes, in the archdiocese and beyond, people suffering, families being broken, dreams being damaged.
If I could, I'd like to say that in the work that I did with Univision Radio, and I am not with Univision America at this point right now, but in the work that I did, it was a political show and a talk show, and people would call in from all over the country. And there were a lot of Hispanics who would also call and say, I played by the rules, and I came here in the right way, and I applied, and I've been waiting 5 or 6 or 7 years for my child to be able to come to the country, family reunification. And now I have, and now I find out if I had brought them in illegally, they would be able to have the benefit that the Sleepers have today. So it is not an easy issue. It's very complicated. Part of the struggles that many Republicans in Congress who are in favor of immigration reform try to find a platform so that there is no preferential treatment for those who are in the pipeline in order to come here is an issue. I think that there is an understanding as well that even though a Republican Congress can pass what they consider immigration reform, it might not meet the approval of the White House and it could be vetoed. And we live in a time today where politically both sides are saying it's my way or the highway. And that is the unfortunate nature of the process today.
And, to give credit where it's due, last year, around May, I remember I met with Congressman Boehner, Speaker of the House, and met with Mario Diaz-Balart, Congressman. And Diaz-Balart was leading among the Republicans in the House a charge to secure a vote on that Senate bill that Marco Rubio got passed in the Senate for immigration reform. It wasn't the greatest bill around because, as you heard, it required a 13-year wait to get citizenship. But at least it would be, you'd have legal status and ability to work, et cetera. He was working on that, and what blew it out of the water was the crisis on the border with the unaccompanied migrants. Because that crisis was going on for a while, but it hit the media in the summer, and that was the time that was going to be voted on. And basically, the votes that Mario was trying to line up to get it through, it all fell apart. Not only that crisis, but also Cantor's loss in Virginia. That loss and the crisis took the wind out of the sails of attempts of Republicans in the House to push the immigration forward. But hopefully, let's keep on going. We continue to advocate.
Thank you. We'll pick it up.
Hi, I'm
Well,
ability of an alien to get a driver's license became impossible, increasingly difficult. And so what you have now are people driving on the streets of Miami, Fort Lauderdale, all across this country, who have jobs, as the Archbishop has said, they have to get to. They have their children they have to take to school, and they have no choice but to get into a car and drive. They have no insurance, and they're putting you and I at risk. That's number one. Number two, these are people who have been here for 10, 20, 30 years in this country. They own property. They are working in all sorts of different fields. They're doctors, they're nurses, they're bankers. They own businesses, they employ people, but they don't have a green card. They don't have residency. So they're contributing to the economy every day. They're also the people who are doing the jobs, as Gypsy said, who we don't want to do. My husband, who's here, is an executive housekeeper at a hotel. It is so difficult every time they place an ad for a housekeeper, a maid, to get someone who is an American citizen or a resident or born in America, not with an immediate immigrant pass, to come in to do that work. So there are industries out there who want to have employees to work. And as the Archbishop said, it's always amazing to me, and I say it in my office, somebody will walk in who is an undocumented alien, but they're working. They're working. And they're people who are born here, and they'll come and tell me they can't find a job. So it's important to get these people to come out of the shadows, to pay the taxes, undergo a background check, and to be able to remain here and be a part of the fabric of what makes this country great. The president's administrative action was not about deporting families. Certainly, we are not arguing for people with heavy criminal backgrounds to be able to remain in the country, and that's a whole separate issue. But the issue that the president put forward is that he wants to keep families here, to keep families together, to perpetuate this American dream, because unless you are a member of the Miccosukee tribe, the Seminole tribe, your ancestors came from somewhere else to be here. So now I'm a new immigrant because I'm from the Caribbean. I'm a new face to America. I may not be from Eastern Europe or from Northern Europe, but I am an American as well. And so we have to embrace the new Americans who are here, who we live amongst down in South Florida more than other parts of the country.
You're not immigrant and you fall in love with undocumented aliens, you get married, might find out that he's going to be deported, and that you can't really fix him because he falls under the 10-year ban. So he's been deported, and he won't be able to apply to come back to the United States for 10 years. So that's one reason why, you know, that you might be concerned about if you're not an immigrant, but you've so much not care about. Right by everybody because they don't end up doing right by you.
I would also say very quickly, it's an issue of national security. When we talk about 9/11 and where we are today, we're talking about issues of great national concern, and we're acknowledging that we have approximately 11 million people who live in the shadows. And we say in the shadows because we don't have proper documentation. Documentation. We all know who they are. They go to school with our kids. And we shop there. They're sometimes neighbors, and we're more familiar with who they are than not. But in other communities, that may not be the case because here we're very open to immigration. South Florida is an exception to the rule to a great degree. But from a perspective of national security, why would you not want to have a better sense of who is here? Why you're here, what are you doing in a healthy sense? I don't want that big brother type of government to be able to say, I don't want a government that also is going to be knocking on doors and asking for papers. Many people are here because of government.
feel free, and then I ask the panelists to address them.
Good afternoon. My name is Sun Jin, a representative of the Haitian student organization here on campus, as well as the Catholic Panthers. My question has to do with the Cuban Adjustment Act. Has there been an attempt to implement an act similar to the Cuban Adjustment Act by the Haitian community?
My name is Julio. I am actually an undocumented student. I come here from FIU. And the reason why I'm still undocumented, I came here when I was 16, 30 days, so I had a qualification background, because I came here 30 days after my 16th birthday. My question has to do with the company minors. I'm from Honduras, so I'm one of them. And then the question is, a lot of them are actually now getting order of removal because they're not even going to court. And what would it take for the government to realize that there's a crisis happening right now? And what if we apply the Cuban Adjustment Act to these minors? Because in the last 10 years, we have had the same amount of Cubans, 40,000 Cubans, arriving to Miami every year. And when we talk about the minors, we call it like an invasion. And it's not different than Cubans coming to the United States.
Thank you. Good question.
Forced to do it. orders in an instant, you know, through electronic banking. And so do people cross borders. And, you know, what we're discussing is the dramatic ways in which many people cross borders. People are crossing borders all the time, and for a fortunate number of them, they come down with the proper documents, et cetera, et cetera. But there is a number that are left out, and refugees, you know, are another issue. People are forced to leave because of political politics or because of economic politics. So, you know, migration is a reality that is part of our localized world, and we're trying to respond to it in a human way. And one way to respond to it is by constructing laws that are just and human and serve the common good. And I think immigration reform serves the common good. As far as the Cuban Adjustment Act, as I said, I think it's a template that should serve as a model of how we should treat other groups in America, because it's worked so very well with the Cubans. We don't see anything like that happening yet. Although in the late 80s or early 90s, there was something in Nicaragua there called the CARA, which was kind of a Cuban Adjustment Act for Nicaraguans. It helped that obligation. I remember as soon as Obama took office, we were pushing for TPS for Asian groups. We were to rebut. Napolitano refused us how many times. But then the earthquake came, and because of the earthquake, then TPS was granted to the Asians here. TPS temporary protected status. There are Hondurans that are in this country since Hurricane Mitch on temporary protected status. That's almost 30 years now, or 20 plus years. Salvadorians around Washington, D.C., a good number of them have TPS because of earthquakes or issues in Central America. Right now, the Haitians are being Haitians that have family members that are approved can come to the United States, or at least if they're approved within the next 2 years. They can come here and wait in the United States for their green card rather than staying in Haiti because the situation in Haiti is deteriorating. So that's a humanitarian gesture. They don't get the green card ahead of anybody else, but they can come to the United States, join their families, get a work permit, and wait for their green card. Sometimes half something. It's better than nothing, but it could have been a lot more generous. So the Cubans really have the gold standard as far as the Adjustment Act. I think it's one way that you look at it and say, let's treat everybody else as well as we treat the Cubans. And I think it would have a positive effect. But I don't think that's going to be much of a chance. I'd say let's work on immigration reform, get it done for everybody.
And you have to remember the comprehensive creation of the Adjustment Act. Immediately after the AFK's disappointment, the speed of it went down, the American administration have been there to provide support. And so a number of things sort of collided or converged to sort of compel the Congress to create this to happen. But in addition to the law, there was so much support that's built into the Human Rights Act in the form of help to such that people reconstruct and rebuild their lives. And I think that Cubans, probably by far, correct me if I'm wrong, the only immigrant group in the history of the United States, I would say, to have benefited from this kind of rich support, not just in terms of the law, the ability to arrive and be eligible for the green card and human to arrival and finding state citizenship, but all the support, right? Support to help you, you know, pick up yourself and figure out the way that this country works. remind us that no one makes this kind of stuff. You know, you don't, you're not going on a cruise when you jump into a raft and decide you're going to come to the United States. It's not, right? The ship is barely seaworthy, or I call it a ship, in my vocabulary is escaping me for a minute, but the thing that they travel in is not seaworthy, right? Generally, we don't know the numbers of people who drown at sea. We don't know the numbers of people who pick up dinners for the sharks. And so I just want to remind us that no one makes this decision right. And next time you're on a cruise, I invite you to just go up on deck, top, at night, and look at what you see out there. You see nothing but pitch blackness, right? And so that's the climate, or that's the backdrop of the travel that someone knows when they come to the United States through a makeshift raft or whatever they create to try to cross. So that's not a decision that we make.
It's also important to take note that we sometimes only think of people who are here undocumented as those who came on boats.
Right.
In actuality, the majority of undocumented people here have actually come on visas and overstayed. So even having said that, that decision to get on a plane and to leave everything you know, there has to be a push, as Archbishop says, factor that's causing you to want to leave, and a pull. The pull factor to come to America is everybody wants to live the American dream, or we want to get the education. We want to have the opportunity to be whoever we can be. It's the only country in the world where you can be born in a shelter and know that if you put your mind to it and you work hard every day, you can become the president of this university, or you can become the head of a hospital. While there are other countries in the world with opportunities, the opportunities that are here, let me qualify that, is more than it is anywhere else. So you find people from all over the world who want to come to America for that opportunity. We happen to live in South Florida, which is the gateway to Latin America and the Caribbean. But if you go to other states throughout the United States, you're going to find other pockets of immigrants. You're going to find pockets of Africans, pockets of Indians, pockets of Russians, Yugoslavians, and they're all going through the same type of immigration battles that we go through here in South Florida. But we know the battle or the plight of the Haitians and the Cubans and the Nicaraguans and the Jamaicans, because that's the majority of who we have here. And so why don't people go back to their countries? Well, that's kind of a political answer, and you posted your political show. Is what can be done from a government perspective to help other countries to build their economies so that less people will want to come here from an economic perspective. Now, the State Department, under Hillary Clinton's leadership, saw the importance of what's called the diaspora. So I'm a member of the Jamaican diaspora because I'm no longer living in my country. Gypsy is a member of the Haitian diaspora living here. The State Department, under Mrs. Clinton's leadership, has seen the importance of the diaspora. And so there have been programs that have been put in place for different members of the diaspora to come together to see how they can benefit their home countries. And as Jamaicans do that, I know the Haitian community also has a very vibrant diaspora. So that's one way that you can help to stop the pull factor. But the pull factor is always going to be there, where people are always going to want to come to America because it's the shining beacon in the world of everything that you can achieve. And to the young man who missed the DACA by 30 days, you certainly would have been, you're an example of somebody who would have benefited from the president's executive action, because the executive action changed the day.
You came
within the time frame, but you came exactly. 30 days too old. So you are really an example of somebody who needs overall immigration reform in order to change your state.
many of them are not going to court. It's a very complex system, but there's something that I find very interesting, and we dance a little bit over the 2016 presidential election, and some of the things that I find absolutely gratifying is that two possible Republican candidates who come from Florida, Marco Rubio and Jeb Bush, have both talked about understanding that the opportunities here, and if they were in similar situations, they would do the same thing, and for the benefit of their families, would come over here and break the law. The struggle that somebody has is that there's this misunderstanding of breaking the law as if all laws are felonies and not. Being here illegally, if I've got it right, it's a civil offense, and it's not a felony. But unfortunately, there is a huge misunderstanding given that issue. And Marco Rubio gets heckled a lot. He gets criticized a lot because he was on the forefront of immigration reform in the Senate side. And then he pushed back because he didn't like the bill at the end of it. And so he gets no benefit. He doesn't get the credit for bringing it forward and having it approved. And he doesn't get credit then after for trying to walk it back. But I will tell you something about Marco Rubio, and that was that six months before the president did deferred action, I called his office and I asked if I could take a number of undocumented students to him so that he could get a sense of who they were and speak to them and see if there was something we could do with immigration reform. And he accepted, and there were maybe 8 or 9 students who went. Some gave their full names, some only gave their first name because they were distrustful. And Senator Rubio, at that point in time, was only in office 6 months ago, and maybe less. And he had a very frank conversation with these students of what could be done and what could not be done. And he allowed them, it was approximately 2-hour meeting, he allowed them to speak about what that experience was, you know, what it was about. They asked if we are legalized, if we are not, I think they spoke about legalization, but it was really not to fear deportation. What does that imply? Do we get social security numbers? Do we get an opportunity to have a driver's license? Do we need that? What happens to our parents? It was a big concern because we live with our parents, will they be kept whole? And it was a fascinating process, and it started what I think is an important conversation. And Gabby Pacheco was a part of that group. And Gabby, for those who may not know, was one of the leaders who really started the DREAM Act from Miami-Dade College. And in that conversation, it was obvious that Gabby, because of her age, was not going to be included in what was being proposed at that time, and indeed doesn't age out for that as well. So you're not alone in missing it because of age, but that's not to say you can't contribute and that you aren't an important part of this conversation in the community, and I just wanted you to know that. I find it ironic that we struggle with this conversation today, and yet, tell me if this isn't strange. We're allowing people to pay for these sorts of things. It's called even the size.
Yes.
And we've even dropped the threshold, which I'm not saying having $500,000 is easy, but if you have $500,000, you can get a visa and come to Miami, and you can promise 10 jobs that you will create with this investment. You don't have to prove that they actually occur. You can promise 10 jobs. We are selling visas to this country, and we have people of value here who deserve the right not fear deportation. I'm not a right to not fear deportation, but who deserve the benefit to be here and to not fear deportation.
We need immigration reform. We shouldn't just give up on this Congress. We have to keep on asking people in this Congress. And I think that NAPA will come up on the table, that the judge put it on a stay, but that could be overruled. It might take some time for it to be overruled. When it gets overruled, then it'll be types of things that lawyers would be asking. And you got to save up your money, because the U.S. government will charge you about $500 to partake in that. And then a lawyer might ask you for a few dollars. I think, you know, for those that are potential beneficiaries of this Band-Aid, which is only a Band-Aid, they should start preparing their documentation for money to participate in the eventuality of the stay being overturned. And in the meantime, since that's only a temporary solution, we all have to go for comprehensive information reform, not only for the beneficiaries of DACA, but for everybody.
I think we have time for maybe a couple more questions.
I'm Professor Milbar of the English Department, so with excellent. I have a question. Everything you were saying is pertinent, very interesting, and very important in terms of trying to resolve issues. The media is important, the church is important, lawyers are important, communal activism is important. But I haven't heard one element which I think might be also significant, system of major importance, and that is education. You're talking about putting the face to the problem, you talk about whether who talks about people. You talk about the law, you talk about different procedures, you talk about a lot of technical things, which are very important. I do not deny the significance of them. But how about education? Is there a role for education to play in advancing the cause that you're so eloquently advocating?
Well, I would say education has been on the forefront of this debate all along, and educational institutions have been the primary opponents of it in particular. But to show you how complicated it is, we did not get state tuition waiver for undocumented students. State tuition, we didn't get our form of green access, which is it was just absolutely astounding. A state where immigration, where the Hispanic population is so significant. It's been there, but for some reason or other, it gets educational institutions push for so many different things. At the end of the day, I think they end up pulling back on some things because they have, in legislatures, they have budget interests that they need to push more strongly than other issues. But I would say that education has been at the forefront of this debate, as have been hospitals as well.
And the human faces, I see them in my pews every Sunday. You see them, yes, that's the human face. So education, like the church has been, the human face on this issue. Because really, we're not talking about statistics. We're talking about beings. They're not breaking the law as much as the law is breaking them. And that's why the law is unjust. That's why the law has to be changed.
And the FIU, the panel that is being done here today, I'm sure, and speak for everybody when I say thank you for hosting us and for providing an opportunity for many others to see this discussion. And this can just be one of many that is held. But certainly, there's a certain amount of fear in the community. You talked about some of the students not giving their last name. There is this fear of deportation that is very real. And from time to time, AILA National in Washington will send an email. There's a reporter doing a story, and they want to see a particular person who fits this demographic, and you can't find anybody because nobody wants to come forward to put a face on it. And so that becomes a little difficult.
Well, there were a lot of raids in the hospitality.
years ago, we have this fear.
It was always there. The fear was always there.
But it's more than a fear, it's a reality.
It's a reality.
Because in the past 6 years, more people
So to address that, I think another element of your comment. I think in the advocacy community, we need to step up the education that I think I'm hearing you speak of through maybe creating more opportunities to share the success stories of immigrants from the country on the one hand, and on the other, to remind our American brothers and sisters, to remind our country of our history and heritage as a land of immigrants, a land, you know, whose riches today, whose riches we all enjoy and benefit from today, created and built upon continuously by immigrants. And so yes, we have a lot more work to do in terms of that,
you know,
community
education. You know,
it's also in terms of the role of humanity.
Yes, yes.
Absolutely, you're absolutely right about that. And just on, just you know, just a thought to throw out there, it's going to be interesting also to see if Jeb Bush were to run for president, he married a Mexican. He's not talking, and he did Peace Corps, and that's where he met her in Mexico City. So he's not, it's not one of those things, it'll be interesting to see how that plays. I was fascinated to see how he presented at CPAC, it's a conservative PAC in the Republican Party. So 25 or 30 people walked out, but the rest stayed. And he got a very big applause, and he has been a pro-immigration reform. And that to me says something, that I think we've reached a tipping point and things are beginning to change in a positive way for this country. And now it needs political will. I know you, and you have every right to just say, like, oh, really? But I will tell you something. A couple of weeks ago, what did John Boehner do? He passed the Department of Homeland Security bill, said, forget the Hastert rule, let's just vote this up or down, and it passed. And you know what? The world as we know it continued. And I think that's a lesson that maybe others are going to notice, that the bread still continues to.
Well, you know, it's interesting that you talk about Jeb Bush, because his name cannot be mentioned on any of the national media circuits in conjunction with his possible run for presidency without talking about, we don't know how his stance on immigration is going to fall out. You know, I would hope that he would step up to the plate, and that's, I think, is a problem that people have with politicians in general, and with Marco Rubio in particular, is because of his wishy-washy, I'm on the fence, I'm off the fence, nobody knows where to stand. I introduced the bill, but I'm not going to back it, but you're not coming up with an alternative, and now you're hands off in immigration, as if all your family came over on the Mayflower. So it's a problem, and if politicians will stand up for what they believe in, I think people will have a lot more respect for them. I certainly would respect Jeb Bush if he steps up to the plate. I'm not going to vote for him, but I'll certainly respect him for stepping up and taking on immigration and putting where he stands on.
They say that making laws are like making sausage. So it's a pretty process. But I think there's got to be a way to get beyond the logjam. I don't think the Republican Party is completely restrictionist. There are certainly some restrictionists in that party, very strong anti-immigration. There's some on the Democratic side as well. But I think that appeals to good angels on everybody's side. And remind people that politics is a double vocation.
Thank you for a wonderful panel.